Recently on this channel, I've covered various services that would be useful for every lunar operator, such as lunar power and thermal management. It isn't hard to think of more common services that could be shared, such as communications, lunar imaging services, infrastructure, mobility, and the use of landing pads. The question arises, how are these services planned, organized, operated, maintained, and upgraded? On Earth, we have the concept of special economic zones, international development organizations and authorities. Could something like that be established on the Moon, and how can it be structured in such a way it benefits space startups and the smaller lunar operators? Well, today, in this video, I introduce a concept of a Lunar Development Cooperative, or LDC for short. This idea comes from Michael Castle Miller, and I've linked in the video description to his white paper called The Lunar Development Cooperative, A Framework for the Sustainable Development of Space, unquote. It's 27 pages long and will be the main reference for this video. One note is that originally I was planning on discussing an alternative authority called the International Lunar Authority, based on port authorities such as New York and New Jersey. These authorities operate infrastructure ranging from bridges to airports. Anyone familiar with these authorities would likely agree it would not be a good idea. These port authorities have resulted in high tolls, crumbling infrastructure, and political bias. As a result, we will discuss the Lunar Development Cooperative, which is a more business-friendly concept that could provide ground rules for lunar operators and especially space startups. First, let's look at the current situation on the Moon. Tragedy of the commons. It's a free-for-all on the Moon at the moment. There are no rules and no one to enforce them anyway. Any actor can land where they want, drive a rover to a key location and leave it there. No one can do anything to stop them. This is a common problem that happens repeatedly on Earth. Take, for instance, overfishing in international waters. The fishing community suffers when the seas are overfished, resulting in loss of income or, in worst cases, bankruptcy and the ruin of entire fishing communities. But, and here's the catch, an individual fisherman is incentivized to fish as much as possible, as the negative impact is spread out against all the community, while the fisherman benefits directly. So the creation of an authority or enforcement mechanism to prevent the unsustainable or inefficient exploitation of resources can be beneficial for all lunar operators. Otherwise, monopolies form, hindering competition, harming operators, and potentially sparking conflict that could result in lost assets, barriers, or heightened risks. Without enforceable rules, commercial activities on the Moon are likely to fall prey to the tragedy of the commons. Why space agencies should establish an authority? It's unlikely that individual lunar operators will establish a rules-based framework on their own. Their incentives will be to monopolize key areas and resources. An international authority will establish standards that are critical for interoperability. For instance, standard power connectors to access a lunar power grid. Every startup or lunar operator will want to impose their connection as a standard. The company who first establishes power infrastructure can just impose their solution on everyone else. The Artemis Accords are great, but are too general to govern commercial activities. It's important any rules benefit economic activity, not hinder it. In many cases, the opposite happens. For instance, the European Union is now discussing a Space Act that will likely impose additional burdens and costs on operators, disproportionately affecting space startups. It's vital if we want to establish a thriving lunar economy that no additional burdens are added to space startups and lunar operators. The solution to these problems is the establishment of the Lunar Development Cooperative. Let's look at this concept now. Lunar Development Cooperative, or LDC. In a nutshell, the LDC is the Moon's primary infrastructure holder and public service provider, fully private and voluntary with no assertion of sovereignty. The LDC is a for-profit, multinational, public-private partnership tasked with deploying and managing future lunar infrastructure for the benefit of all lunar operators in an impartial manner. The LDC is driven by the imperative to attract and retain customers. Shares will be available for anyone who wants to own them, from individuals to private sector investors and even nation states or sovereign wealth funds. investors in the LDC would have a vested interest in keeping the moon open and conflict-free. As lunar activity increases, more shared infrastructure will be built to service all the new operators and activities. The LDC will operate and maintain lunar infrastructure near high-value locations on the moon. Infrastructure includes landing pads, power stations, communication networks, position, navigation and timing services, roads, warehouses, propellant storage facilities, thermal management services and more. It will offer its members other services such as risk insurance, emergency search and rescue, mineralogical data and diplomatic assistance. The LDC would prevent harmful interference between users, resource wastage, ensure interoperability of systems, and other issues necessary for a thriving economic, social, and sustainable future on the moon. These rules are included in contracts with infrastructure users, making the use of LDC infrastructure conditional on compliance with the rules. Violation of the rules results in fines or restrictions, such as quotas imposed on services. Failure to pay fines could result in the LDC suing violators. The suits would be brought to court in the nation where the violator holds assets. Ultimately, the LDC would have the authority to limit or terminate non-compliant users' access to certain services. There are limitations to the authority of the LDC. It cannot enforce rules for parties not under contract. There is nothing stopping competing authorities or frameworks from emerging. If the LDC helps space startups to operate on the moon, then membership will likely grow. If it doesn't, or it hinders growth, it will see competitor organizations forming. LDC rules. LDC contracts with lunar operators will include binding rules covering human rights, labor practices, dust mitigation standards, and harmful interference with other users. Minimum business and technical standards will also be enforced. For example, intellectual property and anti-competitive practices. The LDC cannot compete with its members to provide private goods such as lunar resources. LDC Site Registry, the heart of the system. While international law, specifically the 1967 Outer Space Treaty, bans property ownership off-world, the LDC gets around the problem with an innovation called the Site Registry. The LDC would develop a site use register, where members register their planned activities at locations on the moon. Other members of the LDC would pledge not to interfere with those activities. This registry effectively gets around the no ownership of land rule by allowing exclusive access to certain locations. The membership fee is based on the estimated annual market value of rights recorded in the registry. For instance, a right to mine valuable minerals will result in high membership fees. This is similar to Earth-based systems that manage common pooled resources, such as groundwater basins, irrigation canals, and fisheries. This prevents speculation and monopolization of lunar resources. Managing interference from non-members. The LDC will build larger and higher quality infrastructure than non-member companies or even nation-states can afford to own and operate. This is before factoring in economics of scale that shared infrastructure enables. LDC will use a clustering approach to build infrastructure near key locations, making it less likely that non-members will operate there. This scenario will be like a company on Earth establishing a factory at a location, but with no access to the power grid, water supply, roads, airports, etc. It's technically possible, but very difficult to do. As an example of possible conflicts that could occur without established rules, consider that the Artemis project has a number of candidate sites for its base camp located near Shackleton Crater. The Chinese-led Moon project is also targeting Shackleton Crater as a possible landing site. The Chang'e 7 mission is planning to touch down on the rim of Shackleton Crater in 2026. This could set up a direct clash between competing projects for the same resources. In short, both projects are eyeing the exact same locations within a few kilometers of Shackleton Crater, with the peaks of eternal light, a key but tiny location needed for all year-round solar power generation nearby. If China were to establish solar arrays there, it would crowd out Artemis partners from using that location, making it more difficult for sufficient power to be generated to support a lunar base. There is no formal communication between projects and no way to de-escalate conflict should it occur. China already has a history in the Pacific Ocean of taking assets that don't belong to it and setting up permanent facilities there, which are then used to harass other users. LDC Infrastructure Plan. Years 1 to 3, gathering data on mineralogical composition at key locations near the lunar south pole, deploying orbital telecommunication satellites, providing insurance to lower costs for lunar operators. Years 3 to 7, establish LDC site registry to protect members from interference with registered activities, build and operate landing pads, develop lunar power and optical power beaming systems, construct in-orbit infrastructure for communications, navigation, positioning and timing, establish facilities for reserves of consumables such as water, oxygen, food and critical supplies, provide emergency rescue services. Years 7 to 20 plus. Develop surface transportation networks, including lunar roads and rail systems. Build and operate a lunar rail gun to propel lunar resources into orbit. Build and manage a lunar recycling facility, including biological waste, which connects to all members' habitats. Assist in the formation of strategic reserves of key materials at important locations. Develop a lunar space elevator for low-cost transportation of cargo and goods to and from the lunar surface. The LDC will cluster its infrastructure projects around areas of high interest, such as the moon's south and north poles, permanently shadowed regions, inhabitable lava tubes, and areas of high mineral concentrations. Provide healthcare for space workers and visitors. Comprehensive disaster response capability, including habitat breaches, equipment failure, and space weather events. Final thoughts. The LDC would start with an initial non-profit phase to refine its charter, rules, technical plans, and raise seed funding. Following incorporation, there would be a share offering, with infrastructure missions starting soon afterwards. The LDC is a startup-friendly way to create and maintain vital lunar infrastructure while stopping first-mover land grabs, exclusionary outcomes, and monopolies. Shared infrastructure benefits all lunar operators and reduces costs for space startups that can rely on existing infrastructure, making their business plans more viable and easier to achieve. What do you think of the idea of an international development cooperative? Is it a viable approach to establish shared infrastructure on the moon? Leave your thoughts and opinions in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this space video, consider buying me a coffee to help fund more episodes like this. The link is in the description. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. The live stream is a great way for you to share your thoughts and opinions on the videos I posted this week, or on any space topic in general. I highlight the most thought-provoking comments on videos I received, along with previews of upcoming content. If you got the time, please tune in and say hi. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.